Have you ever watched Star Trek and the Martian? For those who watched, have you ever noticed that Captain Kirk is standing still on the Enterprise? Why is that? I mean, if you are in deep space far from any planet's gravitational attraction, you should be floating because of the absence of gravity. Captain Kirk is standing with his feet on the Enterprise's deck. He seems to weigh the same that he would weigh here on Earth. And also all the objects on the Hermes, as the interplanetary craft in the Martian is dubbed, are behaving as they were in your room, and not in a spaceship traveling in deep space. Something in the Enterprise and the Hermes is simulating and creating gravity. How is it possible? We know that Star Trek is sci-fi, but what about real life? Is it possible to recreate artificial gravity? And why do we need artificial gravity? Let's try to understand it better. Imagine that you're inside a vehicle or another machine, and you are spinning around so fast that the forces press your body against the wall or seat. As you spin faster and faster, that pressure forcing you against the wall increases, and conversely, it decreases as the spin slows down. Sure, you've experienced it before. The weight feels exactly like the force of gravity that keeps your body grounded to the earth. Think about it. You may have experienced it in your childhood when you visited for the first time an amusement park ride, with a classic rotor ride that has produced a great deal of joy since the middle of the 19th century. Do you remember it? How was it? I remember mine. It was so cool. But then I threw up. By the way, a handful of people, including astronauts, experienced the same phenomenon in a human-rated centrifuge, a machine that spins to produce these high G-forces, also called acceleration. They experienced this G-force aboard high-performance aircraft during high-speed turns and during launches into space, and when spacecraft rapidly slow as they re-enter Earth's atmosphere. Now, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever heard of a reduced-gravity aircraft? A reduced-gravity aircraft is a type of fixed-wing aircraft that provides brief, near-weightlessness environments for training astronauts, conducting research and making gravity-free movie shots. Versions of such airplanes were operated by the NASA Reduced Gravity Research Program, and one is currently operated by the Human Spaceflight and Robotic Exploration Programs of the European Space Agency. The unofficial nickname, Vomit Comet, became popular among those who experienced their operation. The aircraft gives its occupants the sensation of weightlessness by following a parabolic flight path relative to the center of the Earth. While following this path, the aircraft and its payload are in free fall at certain points of its flight path. The aircraft is used in this way to demonstrate to astronauts what it is like to orbit the Earth. During this time, the aircraft does not exert any ground reaction force on its contents, causing the sensation of weightlessness. Initially, the aircraft climbs with a pitch angle of 45 degrees using engine thrust and elevator controls. The sensation of weightlessness is achieved by reducing thrust and lowering the nose to maintain a neutral or zero lift configuration, such that the aircraft follows a ballistic trajectory, with engine thrust exactly compensating for drag. Weightlessness begins while ascending and lasts all the way up and over the hump until the aircraft reaches a downward pitch angle of around 30 degrees. At this point, the craft is pointing downward at high speed and must begin to pull back into the nose-up attitude to repeat the maneuver. The forces are then roughly twice that of gravity on the way down, at the bottom, and up again. This lasts until the aircraft is again halfway up its upward trajectory, and the pilot again reduces the thrust and lowers the nose. This aircraft is used to train astronauts in zero-G maneuvers, giving them about 25 seconds of weightlessness out of 65 seconds of flight in each parabola. During such training, the airplane typically flies about 40 to 60 parabolic maneuvers. In about two-thirds of the passengers, these flights produce nausea due to air sickness, giving the plane its nickname, Vomit Comet. But let's go back to the rotor ride. This type of rotation produces gravity, artificial gravity to be precise. It provides weight to your body. You can't distinguish the artificial gravity weight from the weight on Earth. Your bones and your muscles, it would be pretty much the same. If one wants to recreate Earth's gravity on a spaceship, there are two main ways. The first one is to accelerate it at a constant acceleration of 9.81 meters per second squared, and you may think there is no problem with it. but we have to deal with the speed of light. If you had an acceleration of 9.81 meters per second squared, you'd soon reach the speed of light, experiencing all the consequences to which this situation would have. For example, you would find yourself with an unexpected huge mass, so that it would be impossible for you to have the energy to accelerate. The second way is a little bit complicated, but it doesn't have problems in terms of speed of light, because it makes use of rotating spaceships that recreate artificial gravity differently. Consequently, for decades, science fiction writers have envisioned rotating spaceships that create artificial gravity for astronauts during the longest phases of space missions. These phases are when they are not extra heavy due to the ship accelerating to build up speed, or decelerating in the atmosphere, but weightlessness due to the craft coasting, negating the effects of gravity. Before we dive into the last part of the video, please be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel by clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Two examples of artificial gravity in science fiction are the 2015 film The Martian and the 1968 epic 2001 A Space Odyssey. The Martian features the Hermes, an interplanetary craft with a large wheel-shaped section that rotates on its journey between Earth and Mars. Did you see the film? It's one of my favorites. As the camera zooms in, you'll notice that up for astronauts inside the Hermes is always towards the center of the wheel, while down, the floor is the rim. Also, Space Station 5 in 2001 A Space Odyssey is a spinning station that generates artificial gravity equal to that of the moon's gravity. But why do we want to recreate gravity? Is it something that we can avoid, isn't it? Apart from mere comfort, there are good reasons why we need artificial gravity on long-distance space missions. For one, in weightlessness, our bodies change in ways that could be harmful when astronauts arrive at their destinations, such as Mars, or return to Earth. Bones would lose mineral content. They would soften, becoming vulnerable to fracture. Muscles would shrink and weaken. Fluids would shift towards the head and also would be excreted from the body, causing changes in the cardiovascular system and lungs. The nervous system would be thrown out of whack. And in recent years, space medicine researchers have found what could be permanent eye damage in some astronauts. Researchers are getting a better idea of it with volunteers and astronauts, developing new technologies, measuring the damage caused by weightlessness, pushing blood upwards to the head. And we found that arteries get stiffer by quite a bit while they're in space. In fact, in 6 months in space, the arteries get stiffer by the equivalent of about 20 years of aging with muscle and artery damage. Add to that research suggesting that gravity may be required for humans to have a normal pregnancy in space. And it almost seems like a no-brainer that any spacecraft carrying humans around the solar system either should rotate or have some part of the ship that does. Are NASA and others researching the possibility to travel in an artificial gravity spacecraft? The answer is yes. Since the 1960s, NASA scientists have been considering the prospect of artificial gravity by way of rotation. However, the effort, funding, and overall enthusiasm have waxed and waned through the decades. One example is the Nautilus X project. The Nautilus X, non-atmospheric universal transport intended for lengthy United States exploration, is the project of a possible embodiment multi-mission space exploration vehicle, developed by Technology Applications Assessment Team of NASA. The spacecraft was designed for long-duration missions, 1 to 24 months, to travel out of the atmosphere with a crew of six. To reduce the effects of microgravity on human health, the vehicle will be equipped with a centrifuge. The vehicle proposed is relatively cheap by space system standards, being estimated to cost $3.7 billion US. However, this project development was canceled. While NASA has not emphasized research on artificial gravity over the past half century, scientists both inside and outside of the space agency are studying a range of situations. Mice spinning in a small centrifuge aboard the International Space Station survived with no problem, and Earthbound humans are learning how to adapt in spinning rooms. There's one at the Ashton Grabiel Spatial Orientation Laboratory at Brandeis University, and the DLR Institute of Aerospace Medicine in Cologne, Germany, is home to the DLR Short Arm Centrifuge Model 1. It's the only one of its kind in the world researching the effects of altered gravity, especially as it pertains to health risks that occur in microgravity. Why haven't we built ourselves a centripetal space station yet? One problem is the size. In fact, the scale of such a craft would pose some big problems. According to physics, the smaller the spacecraft is, the faster it has to rotate. So if you're going to generate gravity, it's got to be done with a large spacecraft that spins very slowly. The bigger the disk, the slower you can rotate it. For example, one half the usual amount that you feel on Earth, the length of the radius of rotation, the distance from you standing on the floor to the center of whatever is spinning, determines how fast you need to spin. Build a wheel-shaped craft with a radius of 738 feet, 225 meters, and you'll produce full Earth gravity, known as 1G, rotating at just 1 RPM. It would be great. Nobody would vomit in that case. But if the need for artificial gravity is so clear, why bother with research in space or on Earth? Why don't engineers simply get to work designing spinning ships like the Hermes? The answer is that artificial gravity is complicated. It requires a trade-off because all that spinning creates problems. As on the rotor ride, moving your head while you're spinning that fast causes nausea. Anyway, as for Captain Kirk and the objects on the Enterprise, other than the floor being a little bit curved, things aboard such a craft would feel pretty normal. But building and flying such an enormous structure in space would entail enormous engineering challenges. We are pretty sure that even Elon Musk, our hero, doesn't know how to build such a structure. Today's missions, anyway, are fortunately short-term space missions. Short-term space travel doesn't really need artificial gravity. Most of the research done on the ISS relies on the lack of gravity. And on a long-term mission, say to Mars, the last thing NASA wants is an even bigger, fuel-hungrier, more expensive spacecraft. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. What do you think about artificial gravity? Do you think it's possible to create it? Let us know in the comments below. See you next time on the channel.